We will be starting the lecture shortly. Hello. I would like to welcome our listeners around the world who are participating in today's lecture in the second part of the International Committee of the Fourth International's online lecture series commemorating the centenary of the Russian Revolution. My name is Barry Gray. I am the U.S. National Editor of the World Socialist website, and I will be moderating today's lecture. Our speaker is Tom Carter. He is a member of the National Committee of the Socialist Equality Party in the U.S. and a regular writer for the World Socialist website. He has been the principal editor of the weekly chronology of the Russian Revolution that has been running on the WSWS since February. The title of Comrade Carter's lecture is On the Eve of Revolution, the Bolshevik Party, Factory Committees, and the Mass Movement of the Working Class. The first five lectures in this series included the opening lecture, Why Study the Russian Revolution, given by David North, the chairman of the International Editorial Board of the World Socialist website. It was followed by lectures on the 1905 Russian Revolution, World War I as the impetus for the Russian Revolution of 1917, the February Revolution, and a lecture on Lenin's April Theses, which signified the convergence of his perspective with Trotsky's theory of permanent revolution. The first five lectures are published in the volume Why Study the Russian Revolution, Volume 1, The February Revolution and the Development of Bolshevik Strategy, which can be purchased using the link at the bottom of the page. Last week, the first lecture in this phase of the series reviewed the Russian Revolution between the April Theses and the attempted coup by General Kornilov. It focused on Lenin's elaboration of the Marxist conception of the state and the proletarian revolution in the work, The State and Revolution. In today's lecture, Comrade Carter examines the different forms taken during 1917 by the revolutionary movement of the Russian working class, leading up to the mass action of the Red Guards under the leadership of the Bolshevik Party, which smashed the counter-revolutionary coup of the bourgeoisie led by Kornilov. The lecture series will continue with a presentation next Saturday on the Bolshevik seizure of power and discussion of Trotsky's Lessons of October. It will conclude on November 4th with a lecture by David North titled The Place of the October Revolution in World History and Contemporary Politics. If you have not registered for the series, you can do so by visiting wsws.org/1917. If you are listening to this live, there is a registration button on the lecture page. We encourage all those listening live to leave your comments and questions below the YouTube feed on the lecture page. Following the lecture, we will have a question and answer period. You can also submit a question by writing to sep@socialistequality.com or posting to the live Facebook stream. Today's lecture takes place in the context of a profound and intensifying crisis of world capitalism. The bourgeoisie is lurching to the right, gripped by intractable economic, geopolitical, and social contradictions. Its answer is dictatorship and world war. Meanwhile, the indignation and frustration of the masses over growing social inequality, state repression, and militarism increase by leaps and bounds, finding no outlet within the official political establishment. The turn to state violence and dictatorship internationally is summed up in the crackdown by the Spanish government against supporters of independence in Catalonia. The European Union and the US, Canada, and Australia cheer as the right-wing regime in Madrid attacks people lining up to vote, arrests Catalan political leaders, and prepares to impose military rule. In both Germany and Austria, fascists make electoral gains and prepare to enter the German parliament and the Austrian government. The pro-capitalist and pro-imperialist politics of the so-called left, which have enabled far-right policies, parties, by default, to exploit social anger, are demonstrated by the self-abasement of Greek Prime Minister and Syriza leader Alexis Tsipras before Donald Trump in Washington. In the U.S., the Democratic Party and the media quake in their shoes as former Marine General and current White House Chief of Staff John Kelly, whom they praise as one of the moderate and adult generals in the White House, delivers a fascistic rant denouncing Congress and the press. Under cover of anti-Russian hysteria, the political and media establishment demand a crackdown on the internet to purge left-wing and anti-war views. Google, fully integrated into the military intelligence state apparatus, is already censoring the World Socialist website and other left-wing sites. It is part of a corporate state conspiracy to rip up the First Amendment and abolish free speech. At the beginning of the year, the WSWS published a perspective column entitled Socialism and the Centenary of the Russian Revolution, 1917 to 2017. It began, and I quote, "A specter is haunting world capitalism, the specter of the Russian Revolution." Lest anyone think we were exaggerating, it is worth noting that this past week, the Australian Senate passed a resolution denouncing commemorations of the Russian Revolution. The history of the Russian Revolution informs political events today. We are seeking to bring forward that history and the critical political lessons embedded in it as an essential part of the education and preparation of the working class for the new period of revolutionary struggle we are entering. Comrade Carter's lecture provides a living example of the type of mass revolutionary movement that is on the historical agenda. Please join me in warmly welcoming Comrade Tom Carter.
Good afternoon, good evening, or good morning, wherever you may be listening in the world. It is an honor for me to be presenting this lecture today, the subject of which is the most progressive movement in the history of human civilization, a movement in which the founder of our organization, Leon Trotsky, of course, played a critical role. The centenary of the Russian Revolution, which the International Committee of the Fourth International has been commemorating on the World Socialist website, has attracted renewed interest around the world. It has also occasioned the revival and propagation of all of the old slanders and falsehoods about what actually occurred in the final months of the year 1917. The New York Times, a leading voice of American imperialism with close connections to the military and intelligence establishment, has spared no effort this year to denigrate the Russian Revolution in a long series of articles under the caption Red Century. Similar efforts are underway around the world. In many cases, the New York Times simply regurgitates and embellishes, after 100 years, the propaganda of the White Guardists who attempted to overthrow the Soviet government during the Russian Civil War. The Bolsheviks were German agents funded by German gold. The Bolsheviks lacked mass support. The October Revolution was the work of a tiny conspiracy of alien extremists, and so forth. The historian that the New York Times is promoting as an authority on the Russian Revolution, Sean McMeekin, might be called a neo-White Guardist in this respect. According to the narrative presented by McMeekin, the seizure of power by the Bolsheviks was a stab in the back to a nation weakened by war and deprivation, a hostile takeover that McMeekin characterizes as an audacious, chancy, and close-run affair. McMeekin does not hide his political sympathies. Quote, "Despite growing pains, uneven economic development, and stirrings of revolutionary fervor," he writes, "Imperial Russia in 1900 was a going concern, its very size and power a source of pride to most, if not all, of the Tsar's subjects." The trouble with the Russian imperial government, according to McMeekin, was that the Tsar listened to his liberal advisors instead of what McMeekin refers to as the pointed warnings of Rasputin. Soviet power, McMeekin writes, was not a product of social evolution, economic development, or other inexorable historical forces foreseen in Marxist theory, but, quoting the reactionary historian Richard Pipes, the villainous work of, quote, identifiable men pursuing their own advantages. The October Revolution, according to Pipes, represented, quote, the capture of governmental power by a small minority. McMeekin tries to dress up these claims by attributing them to, quote, serious historians. And without a doubt, there are a number of individuals with lofty academic credentials who are promoting these claims around the world. However, all serious and honest historians, whether their political sympathies are with the Bolsheviks or against them, must grapple with overwhelming factual evidence of mass support for the Bolsheviks in the period leading up to October 1917. To borrow a phrase from the American Trotskyist James Cannon, the October Revolution represented a conscious operation. As the historian Rex Wade observes, many writers on the revolution have portrayed the workers as a passive and undifferentiated mass, easily manipulated by radicals and the Bolsheviks. They were far from that. They took an active role in the revolution through factory meetings and committees, through their various organizations, through their support for one party or another, and through the informal street and factory gate meetings that were common. Their participation in the various great demonstrations of 1917, February, and later was a reflection of a decision that this advanced their interests, not a simple manipulation by political parties. They chose to participate. This lecture will deal with some of the most important forms that the mass movement behind the Russian Revolution took, including the factory committees and the phenomenon of workers' control. I will focus on the critical role they played in the period after the July days through to the eve of the Bolshevik insurrection, and in particular during the Kornilov affair. Petrograd, at the beginning of the year 1917, was one of the world's great industrial powerhouses. It was not a provincial backwater, it was the fifth largest city in Europe. Production of war materials for the Tsar's armies was concentrated in its factories, many of which ran on state-of-the-art electric power with the broad introduction of automatic machines. While much of the Russian Empire was indeed mired in terrible rural poverty and backwardness, Petrograd stands out of this landscape with its vast factory districts, legions of workers, and relatively advanced level of manufacturing technology. By 1917, the Petrograd metropolis had drawn in hundreds of thousands of impoverished farmers from the surrounding countryside, proletarianizing them at an accelerating rate. In the 15 years before the war, the ranks of factory workers in Petrograd grew from 73,000 to 242,600. By 1917, the number had grown to 417,000. In Russia as a whole, the working class numbered about 2 million in the year 1917, up from 1.5 million in 1905. Metal workers predominated in the working class of Petrograd, and the machinery they operated must have appeared at the time like something out of science fiction. Up-to-date drilling machines, turret lathes, vertical boring mills, self-acting planing machines, and horizontal milling machines. Petrograd at the beginning of the year 1917 was a city of immense internal tensions and contradictions. Petrograd's ruling elite lived lives of almost fairy tale luxury. They were addressed by their court ranks and adorned themselves with knightly orders. Maids and chauffeurs waited on them in their gold-encrusted palaces. In the same city, in the shadow of the smokestacks and the factory districts, giant tenements reared up next to some of Europe's biggest concentrations of heavy industry. The price of rent in Petrograd was astronomical. Many workers shared the rent of a single bunk in a shared room, with one worker sleeping while the other was on his or her shift. The factory work itself was physically crushing, the air poisonous, and the conditions unsafe. Industrial accidents were common, workers were struck by the machines, or they simply dropped from exhaustion. 10 to 12 hours of bone-smashing work in one of Petrograd's factories brought a worker a handful of kopecks, scarcely enough to pay for food and rent. Families crowded together, often without adequate sanitation, ventilation, or running water. The infrastructure in the proletarian districts was neglected or non-existent. Many workers, despite the low wages, starved themselves to send a few rubles to the countryside, where relatives anxiously depended on them. To meet the high cost of living and rent, tens of thousands of Petrograd women were drawn into the workforce at even lower wages than the men. For the working class of Petrograd, virtually all forms of political expression were banned. Workers were instructed to approach management with grievances in person, one at a time. If workers attempted to go on strike, they risked beatings at the hands of the police, imprisonment, or exile to Siberia. In June 1915, the police opened fire at striking weavers in Kostroma, killing four and wounding nine. 2 months later, troops opened fire on workers in Ivano-Voznesensk. 16 workers were killed and 30 were wounded. The Tsarist authorities maintained a network of informants and secret police in the factory district. Workers that were branded as political were blacklisted, and no factory would hire them. Industries associated with the war effort were under military discipline, and dissent of any kind was labeled as treason. In thousands of cases, the Tsarist authorities conscripted workers who were suspected of political activity into the army and sent them to the front. The bosses ruled over the factories like miniature dictatorships. The foremen rounded up the workers at the start of the shift in the most degrading manner and herded them into the machinery. The workers referred to these factory taskmasters as mini tsars, as American workers today might refer to a particularly abusive manager as a mini Trump. At the end of the shift, workers were searched as they exited the factory, allegedly to prevent them from stealing. Now, the Petrograd workers, of course, resented the low wages and dangerous conditions and lack of political freedom, but they hated especially the searches because they felt that the searches robbed them of some part of their essential dignity as human beings. Despite these oppressive conditions, a vibrant political underground existed in Petrograd. Words like socialism, Marxism, and revolution were in circulation. Despite the odds, factories did go on strike, and if there was a strike as a statistical matter, there is a strong probability that one, there was a Bolshevik cell in the factory, and two, there were workers involved in the strike who had experience in prior strikes. However, the Bolsheviks were not a trade union movement. The Bolsheviks not only organized strikes on economic and workplace issues, wherever possible, they attempted to impart to the economic struggles of the working class an independent political character. The Bolsheviks worked to educate workers regarding history, politics, and culture. They made every effort to bring into the working class a knowledge of the history of its own struggles, an understanding of the political and economic situation and developments in Russia and Europe, an appreciation of the independent political and social interests of the international working class as opposed to the other classes and strata in society. In other words, to develop socialist consciousness in the working class. Since the split between the Bolsheviks and Mensheviks, the Bolsheviks had insisted on a distinction between spontaneous consciousness and socialist consciousness. Quote, "The spontaneous development of the working class movement leads to its subordination to bourgeois ideology," Lenin wrote in What is to Be Done. This is because, quote, "The spontaneous working class movement is trade unionism, and trade unionism means the ideological enslavement of the workers by the bourgeoisie. Hence, our task is to combat spontaneity, to divert the working class movement from this spontaneous trade unionist striving to come under the wing of the bourgeoisie, and instead to bring it under the wing of the Revolutionary Party." This slide shows political strikes between 1905 and 1917. A distinction is drawn between economic strikes and political strikes. An economic strike concerned wages, hours, or conditions. A political strike, on the other hand, challenged government policy, protested the persecution of other workers or their leaders, or marked the anniversary of an important historical event, such as Bloody Sunday. Of course, many strikes contain both political and economic demands, and the consciousness of individual workers involved in a given strike may have gone beyond the demands raised by the leadership. However, the growth of political strikes is an important barometer of political consciousness in the working class movement over this period. Trotsky actually includes this data in the history of the Russian Revolution. With words that have a certain resonance today, Trotsky describes the resurgence of the revolutionary working class struggle after the period of reaction that followed the 1905 revolution. Quote, "Great defeats discourage people for a long time. The consciously revolutionary elements lose their power over the masses. Prejudices and superstitions not yet burnt out come back to life. Skeptics ironically shake their heads. So it was in the years 1907 to 1911. But molecular processes in the masses heal the psychological wounds of defeat. A new turn of events or an underlying economic impulse opens a new political cycle. The revolutionary elements again find their audience. The struggle reopens on a higher level." I want to refer to a brief excerpt from the memoir of Alexander Buiko, a Bolshevik metal worker who actually worked in the Putilla factory before the revolution. In this passage, he describes his efforts to win over his fellow metal workers, among whom he encountered some of the old craft prejudices common among what were then referred to as skilled workers. It provides some sense of the years of patient work the Bolsheviks conducted at the ground level. Buiko writes, quote, "If a young man began a conversation with an older skilled fitter or turner, he would be told, 'Learn first how to hold a hammer and use a chisel and a knife, and then you can begin to argue like a man who has something to teach others.' For many years, we had to put up with this. If you wanted to be an organizer, then you had to know your job. If you did, then they would say of you, 'He's not a bad lad. He works well, and he's got a smart brain when it comes to politics.'" Now, this is a picture of four Bolsheviks who had been assigned to the Putilov works before the revolution. They are on vacation together in Kislovodsk in 1926, almost a decade after the revolution. They had all been arrested together by the Tsarist authorities in 1906. Buiko is on the left, on the right. Standing next to him is a figure that might be familiar to some listeners, namely Alexander Voronsky. Voronsky was a leading Soviet literary figure, the author of Art as Cognition of Life, and a major figure in the left opposition. In its campaigns in the working class, the Bolshevik Party insisted that workers of all races, backgrounds, and sexes must unite in a common struggle against capitalism and war. The Bolshevik Party featured a remarkable number of women leaders under the circumstances: Nadezhda Krupskaya, Alexandra Kollontai, Elena Stasova, and others, and published a newspaper addressed to working class women, Rabotnitsa. This slide has a picture of Klavdia Nikolaeva. The daughter of a worker, Klavdia Nikolaeva was born in 1893 and joined the Bolshevik Party in 1909, which would have been around age 16. In 1917, at around age 24, she served on the editorial board of the journal Rabotnitsa in Petrograd, a major political responsibility. The Bolshevik Party included many such young leaders who can only be described as political prodigies. After the revolution, Nikolaeva supported Trotsky and was a member of the left opposition. Even if all workers did not necessarily agree with the Bolsheviks at first, through a long period of persistent underground work, the Bolsheviks became associated in the minds of the Petrograd workers with the most far-reaching demands for political emancipation, social reorganization, peace, equality, and human progress. The Bolsheviks gained respect as the most serious, the most courageous, and the most principled fighters for the interests of workers. Trotsky cites the words of a police report concerning the Bolsheviks in the period leading up to the war. This is the police, quote, the most energetic and audacious element, ready for tireless struggle, for resistance and continual organization, is that element, those organizations, and those people who were concentrated around Lenin," unquote. By early 1917, the names of factories such as Ivas, Baranovsky, Vulcan, Nobel, New Lessner, Phoenix, and Puzyrov had become synonymous with strong contingents of militant workers who were members or sympathizers of the Bolshevik Party. In February 1917, as we know, the Bolshevik, the working class of Petrograd, did overthrow the Tsarist regime, and this great seething political underground burst above ground. The February Revolution was indeed carried out by conscious and tempered workers educated for the most part by the party of Lenin, as Trotsky writes. However, the mass revolutionary movement of the working class in February was not yet united and guided by the Bolshevik Party. Consequently, while workers were successful in toppling the Tsar, the February Revolution brought forth a heterogeneous proliferation of workers' struggles and organizations of all shapes and sizes throughout Petrograd and throughout the country, including labor unions, factory committees, and Soviets. The revolutionary workers of Petrograd, during and after February, raised numerous and varied demands, both political and economic. Following the February Revolution, one particularly colorful demand was that workers receive full pay for the days they spent overthrowing the Tsar. During the February Revolution, there was a widespread phenomenon known as carting out. The workers in Petrograd's factories literally grabbed the managers and foremen, put them in wheelbarrows, wheeled them out of the factory, and dumped them outside. The practice of carting out caught on quickly and became quite widespread. The historian Stephen A. Smith writes, quote, "Carting out was a symbolic affirmation by workers of their dignity as human beings and a ritual humiliation of those who had deprived them of this dignity in their day-to-day working lives." In other words, the workers were not content to simply depose the Tsar. It was necessary to depose all of the mini Tsars in the factories as well. At many factories, workers went further. Having carted out the bosses, they asserted control of their factories, and the factory committees were the form workers used to exercise this control. Factories throughout the former Tsarist Empire followed suit. The form and structure of these committees differed from factory to factory and from city to city. But what distinguished the factory committees from the labor unions was the concept of workers' control. The factory committees seized and opened the books of their factories. In some cases, they discovered that when the employers had been insisting that wages remain low due to the alleged unprofitability of the factory, the bosses had in fact been raking in profits. The factory committees took stock of finances and inventory. Capitalists and reactionaries were continually trying to discredit the workers' movement by sabotaging production and distribution, and the committees blocked and exposed these efforts. The committees unilaterally asserted control over hiring and firing. They declared that they had the right to fire abusive managers and rehire the workers who had been blacklisted. This phenomenon was accurately predicted by Trotsky before 1917. In his dispute with Lenin over the slogan of the democratic dictatorship of the proletariat and peasantry, Trotsky foresaw that the proletariat will be pushed toward power by the whole course of the revolution. It would not be able to stop artificially at overthrowing the Tsar and the creation of a bourgeois democratic regime. As the leading social force in the revolution, the working class should not and could not be restrained from taking class measures to secure and advance its interests, beginning at the workplace. Now, when discussing a hurricane of social struggles like 1917, one encounters difficulty in making universal characterizations. For each general characterization, there are exceptions, regional variations, and shifts and fluctuations over time. Bolsheviks, Mensheviks, socialist revolutionaries, and unaffiliated workers were all active in both the labor unions and the factory committees. Nevertheless, taking Russia as a whole in 1917, it can be said that the labor unions tended to be more conservative or politically neutral and to favor the policies of the Mensheviks and the SRs. Meanwhile, the factory committees were a bastion of Bolshevik support. The Bolsheviks encouraged the formation of these committees, delegated assemblies of factory committees repeatedly endorsed Bolshevik resolutions. The Provisional Government sought to combat the factory committees by granting them legal recognition, while at the same time attempting to limit them essentially to the role of trade unions. In a speech to a Congress of Factory Committees in June, Lenin urged workers to reject such efforts. "Comrades, workers," he said, "see that you get real control, not fictitious control, and reject in the most resolute manner all resolutions and proposals for establishing fictitious control existing only on paper." The factory committees spread rapidly, and at that conference of factory committees, 100% of factories with more than 5,000 workers were represented. Delegates attended these conferences fresh from the assembly lines, having been elected by their co-workers on the shop floor. "By taking into our own hands the control of production," one worker delegate is recorded as saying, "we will learn about its practical aspects and raise it to the level of future socialist production." The employers, of course, fought as best they could against the formation of these committees. There's an account of one leather manufacturing workshop with 19 workers, where the workers attempted to form a committee and the employer fired the entire workforce. In other cases, management tried to fire the leadership of the committees, and workers were compelled to strike to reinstate the leaders. When workers and their families were starving, factory committees attempted to procure food and organize the food supply. The factory committees imposed labor discipline at the factories, and they waged a campaign against alcohol abuse. In the chaos and anarchy of the revolutionary period, the workers' committees kept production lines going, producing desperately needed tools, clothing, and commodities. Perhaps most disturbing to the authorities, many factory committees declared that they had no confidence in the armed forces of the Provisional Government, and so they formed their own militias called Red Guards. It was the Bolshevik factories, in particular, where the Red Guards were formed the most consistently and where they were the most militant. This is a company of Red Guards from the Vulcan factory. In the Peterhof district on April 26, the workers set limits on who could join the Red Guards. Quote, "Only the flower of the working class may join. We must have a guarantee that no unworthy or wavering people enter its ranks. Everyone wishing to enroll in the Red Guard must be recommended by the district committee of a socialist party." Men as well as women served in the Red Guards. The Red Guards provided security for the factory districts and defended workers' homes and workplaces from a wave of arson attacks by far-right forces. The Red Guard proclaimed that only the working class can defend and advance the gains of the Russian Revolution against the forces of counter-revolution. The Mensheviks denounced the Red Guards and blamed their formation on Leninist agitation. The factory committees took up cultural questions with great interest. In the Putilov works, workers founded a cultural club that had a library and a buffet. This club had a membership of 2,000. The club defined its aim as to, quote, "unite and develop the working class public in a socialist spirit, to which and our necessary general knowledge and general development, resting on basic literacy and culture." On Vasilevsky Island, a club named New Dawn was founded in March 1917 that soon had 800 members from the pipe works. This club organized a geographical expedition, a steamer expedition, lectures, and a brass band concert for workers. When the Gunworks Club was opened, there was a recital of arias from operas by the Russian composer Modest Mussorgsky, and a performance by a band of workers of the Internationale and the Workers' Marseillaise. The club had a library of 4,000 books, a reading room, a small theater, and a school. Evening classes were held in literacy, legal affairs, natural sciences, and mathematics. At workers' clubs in Petrograd, plays were staged by the famous Russian writers Alexander Ostrovsky, Lev Tolstoy, Nikolai Gogol, as well as German playwright Gerhard Hauptmann and others. The Bolsheviks, as we know, refused to support the Provisional Government or the war. Throughout the year, they carried out a political struggle in the working class in opposition to all other tendencies. Under the impact of events, the factories one by one began to swing to the Bolshevik Party. In the history of the Russian Revolution, Trotsky singles out one organizer in particular for praise at the Putilov Works. Quote, "The Putilov factory, with its 40,000 workers, was a stronghold of the social revolutionaries during the first months of the revolution. But its garrison did not defend it long against the Bolsheviks. At the head of the Bolshevik attack, most often was to be seen Volodarsky, a tailor in the past. A Jew who had spent some years in America and spoke English well, Volodarsky was a magnificent mass orator, logical, ingenious, and bold. His American intonation gave a unique expressiveness to his resonant voice, ringing out concisely at meetings of many thousands. From the moment of his arrival in the Narva district, says the worker Minichev, the ground in the Putilov factory began to slip under the feet of the social revolutionary gentlemen, and in the course of something like 2 months, the Putilov workers had gone over to the Bolsheviks." This slide has a picture of Volodarsky. In the United States during the war, he was active in the International Trade Union of Tailors and the Socialist Party. He wrote for a newspaper in New York. He joined Trotsky's Mezhrayonci after his arrival in Russia, and then joined the Bolshevik Party with Trotsky. He was assassinated by SRs in 1918. The Putilov Works Committee urged workers to attend evening classes. Quote, "Let the idea that knowledge is everything sink deep into our consciousness. It is the essence of life, and it alone can make sense of life." In another resolution, they wrote, quote, "Questions of culture and enlightenment are now the most vital burning questions. Comrades, do not let slip the opportunity of gaining scientific knowledge. Do not waste a single hour fruitlessly. Every hour is dear to us. We need not only to catch up with the classes with which we are fighting, but to overtake them. That is life's command. That is where the finger is pointing. We are now the masters of our own lives, and so we must become masters of all weapons of knowledge." The literacy rate among Putilov fitters was as high as 94.7%, according to one survey. Among Petrograd metal workers in general, it was 92%. This is compared to 17% at the same time in the countryside in European Russia. In many ways, the expression of workers' control after February was a reflection in the workplace of the dual power that existed on the political plane. Certain aspects of control in the workplaces passed de facto into the hands of the revolutionary workers, but the legal ownership and right of disposition remained de jure in the hands of the capitalists. Trotsky called the phenomenon of workers' control, under the right conditions, a school for planned economy. Along these lines, during 1917, the Putilov Works Committee gave the following detailed instructions about setting up shop committees. Quote, "It is necessary that these committees, which look after life at the grassroots, should display as much independence and initiative as possible. The success of the labor organizations in the factories fully depends on this. By becoming accustomed to self-governance or self-management, the workers are preparing for that time when private ownership of factories and works will be abolished, and the means of production, together with the buildings erected by the workers' hands, will pass into the hands of the working class as a whole. Thus, while doing the small things, we must constantly bear in mind the great overriding objective towards which the working people is striving." Now, the ruling class, reeling from the February Revolution, was compelled to acquiesce to workers' control for a short period of time. But as soon as the capitalists had regained their balance, they were determined to reassert their prerogatives. Trotsky later wrote, "The contradictions, irreconcilable in their essence, of the regime of workers' control will inevitably be sharpened to the degree that its sphere and its tasks are extended and soon will become intolerable." Trotsky explained that there were only two ways out of this dual power situation. either the capture of political power by the working class or a counter-revolutionary dictatorship. In Russia in 1917, the latter alternative took the form of the attempted putsch by General Kornilov, known as the Kornilov Affair. The context for this coup has already been discussed in last week's lecture. By all accounts, Lavr Kornilov was a thuggish and unappealing character. His colleague, General Martinov, described him as an absolute ignoramus in the realm of politics, while General Alexeyev described him as a man with a lion's heart and the brains of a sheep. Kornilov was fond of parading himself with troops arrayed in ethnic uniforms, brandishing sabers, fiercely glaring at crowds of his supporters. A short, bandy-legged man physically, he cultivated the image of a vicious attack dog. He was a sympathizer of the Black Hundreds, the Russian equivalent of the Ku Klux Klan. Kornilov's military career was not particularly illustrious. He was captured by the Austrians while wandering in the woods in 1915, but managed to escape. During the failed Kerensky offensive, he distinguished himself by ordering retreating troops to be fired upon indiscriminately. The soldiers naturally hated him for this, but in far-right circles, it made him a national hero. After abandoning Riga later in the war, Kornilov ordered his officers to randomly shoot soldiers on the side of the road for cowardice, even though the soldiers had in fact fought valiantly. When officers refused to carry out these atrocities, Kornilov flew into a rage and threatened to court-martial his own officers for insubordination. Kornilov's political program was crude but simple. While the two-faced Kerensky purported to negotiate with the moderate socialist parties, such as the Mensheviks and SRs, Kornilov would stoop to doing no such thing. As far as Kornilov was concerned, all socialists, Bolsheviks, Mensheviks, SRs, were Russia's internal enemies and very likely the paid spies of foreign powers. Kornilov would march on the capital, smash the workers' organizations, hang the leaders, and use artillery against anyone who attempted to stand in his way. Among the elite Tsarist military castes, the government bureaucrats, the landowners, the clergy, and the business and banking magnates, Kornilov rapidly became imbued with the halo of a national savior. The entire mainstream press supported him. He even enjoyed the support of leading SRs, including Boris Savinkov, as well as Kerensky himself. Kornilov's march on Petrograd was preceded by a series of intrigues between Kerensky and Kornilov. Kerensky, of course, was no less a Kornilovite than Kornilov. The dispute between the two men was over which of them would be at the head of the government of blood and iron that they both agreed was necessary to crush the workers of Petrograd. It was Kerensky who appointed Kornilov to the head of the army on July 31st, seeking to use Kornilov's growing support within the political establishment for his own benefit. On August 24th, Kornilov told his chief of staff that it was, quote, high time to hang the German agents and spies headed by Lenin and to disperse, quote, the Petrograd Soviet in such a manner that it could not reassemble anywhere. On August 25th, Kornilov ordered the army to march on Petrograd. He declared, quote, the corps will be in place in the suburbs of Petrograd by the evening of August 28th. I request that Petrograd be proclaimed under martial law on August 29th. The troops dispatched to Petrograd included the Caucasian Native Cavalry Division, the Tsar's infamous Savage Division. Kornilov's supporters could barely conceal their eagerness for the upcoming bloodbath in the capital. They boasted openly, quote, mountain men do not care whom they kill. One recalls the slogans later in use by the White Army, quote, we have no restrictions. God is with us. Slash right and left. The modern equivalent would be the slogan associated with the American occupation forces in Iraq, kill them all and let God sort them out. What was Kornilov preparing to do with the military in Petrograd? When the 1905 revolution was defeated in Russia, the military shelled the Presnia district in Moscow. The entire factory district, packed with workers and their families, was reduced to rubble. Punitive expeditions fanned out across the railway lines. As Fred Williams said in his lecture, the troops would come into a railway station and just start shooting everybody, whoever happened to be near. Women, children, railway workers, whoever was there, just gunned them down. Some were hanged along the way to terrify people. It's worth remembering the year 1871 was the same distance away from 1917 as 1971 is to today. The massacre of the communards in Paris had occurred during the lifetimes of many members of the Bolshevik Party, and the leadership never lost sight of that danger. When the counter-revolutionaries seized power in Finland in 1918, Victor Serge estimates that in total, over 100,000 Finnish workers were massacred. It should also be remarked that among Kornilov and his supporters, there was a strong component of pathological anti-Semitism. The British war correspondent John Ernest Hodgson, who spent some time with the Kornilovite general Anton Denikin, made the following observations. "I had not been with Denikin more than a month before I was forced to the conclusion that the Jew represented a very big element in the Russian upheaval. Their officers and men of the army laid practically all of the blame for their country's troubles on the Hebrew. They held that the whole cataclysm had been engineered by some great and mysterious secret society of international Jews who, in the pay and at the orders of Germany, had seized the psychological moment and snatched the reins of government. All of the figures and facts that were then available appeared to lend color to this contention. No less than 82% of the Bolshevik commissars were known to be Jews, the fierce and implacable Trotsky, who shared office with Lenin, being a Yiddisher whose real name was Bronstein. Among Denikin's officers, this idea was an obsession of such terrible bitterness and insistency as to lead them into making statements of the wildest and most fantastic character. During the Civil War, the White Armies massacred Jews throughout European Russia and exhorted their followers to destroy, quote, the evil that lurks in the hearts of the Jew communists. Many historians will, from their respective vantage points, deplore the violence of the Russian Civil War. But it should be remembered what Trotsky and the Red Army were up against. It should come as no surprise that many of Kornilov's supporters, later in their careers, would support and collaborate with the Nazis. These were the forces that were marshaled behind the Kornilov coup. When Kerensky was first informed by Prince Lvov of Kornilov's demands, Kerensky thought it was a joke, and so he burst out laughing. Prince Lvov gravely informed him that it was no laughing matter, and that Kerensky himself, if he valued his life, would leave Petrograd as fast as possible. To lead the march on Petrograd, Kornilov chose General Krimov, who declared that he would not hesitate, if necessary, to hang the entire Soviet membership. On the day of August 28th, the stock market in Petrograd soared upwards in anticipation of Kornilov's imminent triumph. As word reached the factory districts, the factories, one by one, started blaring their alarm whistles. The workers of Petrograd had been through 1905, and they knew what Kornilov would do if he was allowed into the city. The Bolshevik leaders in the factory districts had been warning about this danger all year. The Bolsheviks had explained that the ruling class was simply biding its time, and sooner or later, it would abandon its fake reforms and fake coalitions and attempt to crush the working class with force. Workers heard the alarms and came out into the streets, and the Bolshevik leaders were already at their posts, issuing orders for the defense of the city. Within hours, the city was firing on all cylinders, and the organized working class rose up with full force. In May, when Tseretelli and the Soviet leadership were persecuting the more radical sailors of Kronstadt, Trotsky came to the sailors' defense. Trotsky warned Tseretelli that when a counter-revolutionary general tries to throw a noose around the neck of the revolution, the cadets will soap the rope and the Kronstadt sailors will come to fight and die with us. And Trotsky was right on all counts. He was right about the counter-revolutionary general, he was right about the cadets, and he was right about the Kronstadt sailors. When they received word that Korniloff was at the gate, they marched into the capital, armed to the teeth, ready to give their lives to defend it. The sailors from the Aurora sent a special delegation to the prison where Trotsky was being held to ask his advice. Should they defend the Winter Palace, or should they storm the Winter Palace? Trotsky told them that they should deal with Korniloff first and then square their account with Kerensky. The Bolshevik Party spearheaded efforts to defend the city. The entire population of the city was mobilized, digging trenches, stringing barbed wire, and organizing the delivery of supplies to the fortifications. The Menshevik internationalist Sukhanov later observed, quote, "The Committee for Struggle Against the Counter-Revolution, making defense preparations, had to mobilize the worker-soldier masses. But the masses, insofar as they were organized by the Bolsheviks and followed them. At that time, theirs was the only organization that was large, welded together by elementary discipline, and linked with the democratic lowest levels of the capital. Without it, the committee was impotent. Without the Bolsheviks, it could only have passed the time with appeals and idle speeches by orators who had lost their authority. With the Bolsheviks, the committee had at its disposal the full power of the organized workers and soldiers." When Korniloff's supporters tried to dispatch telegrams, the telegraph workers refused to send them. When they stepped into their cars and demanded to be taken to government buildings, the chauffeurs refused to transport them. When they tried to have leaflets printed, typesetters refused to touch the machines. When officers ordered their soldiers to support Korniloff, the soldiers seized and detained the officers. Workers in the factories associated with the war industry produced weapons for themselves and carried them into the streets. Following the July days, the Provisional Government had attempted to disarm the Red Guard companies, but was only successful in driving them underground. Workers allowed the authorities to confiscate the older and less useful weapons, but concealed the most valuable weapons wherever they could. During this period, the Bolsheviks developed the Red Guard from an armed militia of the factory districts into the core of a Bolshevik army. The Red Guard companies, like the factory committees, were formally non-party, but Bolshevik workers increasingly constituted the core of each company as well as the leadership. The Bolshevik Party provided the Red Guard detachments with military instructors and, wherever possible, weapons. Military drills were conducted at first inside workers' flats and tenements, and then openly in the factory yards. With Korniloff marching towards Petrograd, companies of Red Guards emerged onto the streets, armed with rifles and machine guns. Tens of thousands strong, the Red Guards quickly established control over all the key strategic locations in Petrograd. In the factory districts, the Red Guards established recruiting stations and long lines formed of volunteers. Railway workers sent warnings along the tracks that nobody should transport any soldiers. They filled railway cars with lumber and placed them across the tracks. They tore up miles of railway lines in every direction. In some cases, they loaded Korniloff's troops onto the trains and then transported them in the opposite direction, away from Petrograd. Krimov's forces quickly became stranded along hundreds of miles of track. Revolutionary orators from Petrograd then made their way to the stranded trains and began addressing the troops. One can imagine Krimov's dismay when the soldiers under his command began holding mass meetings to decide what to do, electing committees, arresting officers, and passing resolutions. One by one, red flags started to appear over Korniloff's divisions. Even the so-called Savage Division, after meeting with Muslim delegates to the Soviet Congress, raised the red flag. Within days, Korniloff's coup had evaporated. Trotsky later observed, quote, "The army that rose against Korniloff was the army to be of the October Revolution. In stopping the advance of Korniloff, the working class flexed its muscles for the first time under the leadership and direction of a revolutionary Marxist party. Having measured their strength with the forces of the counter-revolution, the Petrograd workers looked around and took stock of the situation. Led by the Bolsheviks, they were stronger than Kornilov. They were stronger than Kerensky and his supporters among the SRs and Mensheviks. There was no social force that could stop them. The mood was elated. Workers and soldiers regarded themselves as heroes, having saved the country from a terrible disaster. The sentiment recalled by a soldier of the armored car division, quoted by Trotsky, was, "Well, if there is such bravery, we can fight the whole world." The Bolsheviks had correctly warned that there could be no coalition with the bourgeoisie. The bourgeoisie was determined at the first opportunity to stomp the working class back down into slavery. All the parties that had supported compromise with the bourgeoisie were discredited, including the Mensheviks and the SRs. As the Bolsheviks had warned, the choice was between a counter-revolutionary dictatorship and workers' power. The workers saw that they had no choice but to take power for themselves. The SR party, which was based in the peasantry and the enlisted soldiers, suffered a massive collapse. A section of the SR leadership was deeply implicated in the Kornilov coup, and support for the party had already been declining as a result of its failure to secure any significant land reforms. The masses, having lost confidence in the parties of the Soviet majority, saw with their own eyes the danger of counter-revolution, Trotsky writes in Lessons of October. They came to the conclusion that it was now up to the Bolsheviks to find a way out of the situation. In the wake of the defeat of the Kornilov coup, Bolsheviks won majorities in the Moscow and Petrograd Soviets, as well as a growing number of regional Soviets. At a trade union congress in the Urals representing 150,000 workers, Bolshevik resolutions carried. One soldier of the Moscow garrison recalled that, quote, "all the troops acquired a Bolshevik color. All were struck by the way in which the statement of the Bolsheviks came true, that General Kornilov would soon be at the gates of Petrograd." An all-Russian conference of factory and workshop committees passed a resolution declaring that workers' control, quote, "is in the best interest of the whole country and ought to be supported by the revolutionary peasantry and the revolutionary army." Trotsky recalls, quote, "the resolution, opening the door to a new economic order, was adopted by the representatives of all of the industrial enterprises of Russia, with only 5 votes opposing and 9 votes abstaining." The emergence of a Bolshevik majority in the Soviets was a turning point in the Russian Revolution. Prior to the Kornilov affair, the Bolsheviks had been a minority in the system of Soviets established after February. On October 8th, to arguably the most important post in revolutionary Russia, the post of chairman of the Petrograd Soviet, the new majority elected Leon Trotsky, who had served as the Soviet's leading spokesman during the 1905 revolution. At the time of his election, Trotsky, newly released from prison, was still technically under indictment by the Kerensky government for high treason. When he ascended the platform, he was greeted by the workers' and soldiers' delegates with what one observer called a hurricane of applause. "Bolshevism took possession of the country," Trotsky writes. "The Bolsheviks became an unconquerable power. The people were with them." The rapid swing from minority to majority prompted the emergence of a sharp controversy within the Bolshevik leadership over what to do next. And that controversy will be the subject of the next lecture. In an article this year entitled, quote, "The February Revolution and Kerensky's Missed Opportunity," the New York Times conveniently leaves out the name of Kornilov entirely. The establishment of Soviet power after October is deplored, but the alternative is simply omitted. But the New York Times knows better, since in 1917, as a matter of fact, the New York Times endorsed Kornilov. As a matter of fact, the New York Times first endorsed Kerensky for the post of dictator of Russia, then they endorsed Kornilov. Sean McMeekin is more explicit. This is what he writes about the Kornilov affair. Quote, in a short-sighted move, Kerensky allowed the Bolshevik military organization to rearm, thus acquiring the weapons they would use to oust him 2 months later. The meaning here is plain. To refuse to allow the Bolsheviks to take up arms means to allow Kornilov into Petrograd. If Kornilov had not been stopped, we would naturally not be learning about the October Revolution of 1917 today. In the absence of the October Revolution, our world would obviously look very different. The year 1917 would not mark the foundation of the first socialist worker state. Instead, 1917 would mark the foundation of the 20th century's first genocidal dictatorship, not in Spain or Italy or Germany, but in Russia in 1917. The Kornilov coup of August 1917, if successful, would have brought into power a gang of deranged generals, pathological anti-Semites, and religious zealots who openly boasted about the bloodbath they were preparing in Petrograd. After putting all the socialists up against the wall, they would have fanned out across Eastern Europe and Asia, exterminating socialists wherever they could find them, and they would have enjoyed the enthusiastic support of the Russian capitalists, generals, clergy, and aristocrats for this project, together with the support of France, Britain, and the United States. When one hears denunciations of the Bolsheviks from the likes of the New York Times, what they are really saying is that they would have preferred Kornilov. The New York Times was outraged by Kornilov's defeat in 1917, and 100 years later, they are still angry about it. Fortunately for the working class in Petrograd, and fortunately for human civilization on planet Earth, Kornilov was stopped in 1917, and he was not permitted to put his program into effect. What is the significance of this history? In the days of the old Southern slavocracy in the United States, it was against the law to teach a slave to read. The slave owners were terrified of what might happen if political consciousness developed among the slaves. In the same way today, in 2017, every effort is made to cut off workers and youth from the history and traditions of the Russian Revolution. The ruling classes are terrified of what might happen if the oppressed masses of humanity discover what politically conscious workers, organized and theoretically guided by a revolutionary Marxist party, can accomplish. This is what accounts for the new wave of falsifications and slanders directed against the Bolsheviks in the year 2017. The Bolshevik Party led a politically conscious mass movement. The impact of this movement across time and geography is without parallel. This was the most powerful and progressive movement in world history so far. The most powerful and progressive movement in world history so far. The international working class, as it rises to confront the challenges of the 21st century, can and must go further. The Bolshevik program represented nothing less than the reorganization of human civilization on the entire planet at a more advanced and rational level, putting an end to imperialist war and the exploitation of man by man. Their aim was to bring down all the governments, open all the borders, and stop all the wars. And this program found mass support, not only in Russia but around the world, because it intersected with the objective interests and struggles of the most powerful and progressive social force in world history, the international working class. Thank you.
Thank you, Comrade Tom, for that very extremely interesting, inspiring, and informative lecture. Now, we encourage everyone to leave questions in the discus field or to write to sep@socialistequality.com. Before we proceed to the question and answer period, several points I would like to make. First of all, as is really very clear from the lecture that Comrade Tom gave and all of the lectures that have been given, the great question of history and the great question of politics today is the question of revolutionary leadership. And the fact that the International Committee of the Fourth International and the Socialist Equality Parties are the only organization which is seriously commemorating the centenary of the Russian Revolution is completely bound up with the fact that it uniquely embodies and represents the revolutionary program and traditions of the Bolsheviks and the Trotskyist movement today. So we strongly encourage everyone who's listening to make the necessary and critical decision to join the International Committee of the Fourth International and the Socialist Equality Party in your country. Again, I want to remind all of our listeners that the first series of lectures, which we have held, is published in the book, Why Study the Russian Revolution, Volume 1, The February Revolution and the Development of Bolshevik Strategy, which can be purchased by using the link at the bottom of the lecture page. Also, we encourage everybody to purchase the documentary film Tsar to Lenin, which is the greatest documentary of the Russian Revolution, produced by Herman Axelbank and narrated by Max Eastman. It can also be purchased by using the link on the bottom of the page. Of course, the importance of this lecture and the whole series we're holding and the entire commemoration, the series of weekly chronological expositions on the World Socialist website is precisely, as Comrade Tom explained, to bring into the working class all over the world an understanding of its own revolutionary history and the immense power that it possesses and its ability with a correct program and leadership to change the world. And today, under conditions of immense crisis, that's precisely why there is a very concentrated, systematic, and international effort to crack down on the internet and exclude all left-wing, progressive, anti-war websites, particularly the World Socialist website. As the WSWS has documented and exposed, there is a systematic exclusion of the WSWS from Google search results, which has been going on since April, cutting back our referrals from Google by some 75%, which is being carried out under the guise of filtering out so-called fake news and promoting so-called authoritative content. And particularly, the WSWS has been blacklisted in searches relating to history, especially the history of the revolutionary struggles of the 20th century. And our movement has produced a tremendous amount of invaluable literature, books on this question, including a whole series of books authored by David North. When you search for terms such as Russian Revolution, Bolshevik Revolution, October Revolution on Google, you will not find the WSWS. And prior to April, such searches turned up the WSWS among the top 50 lists listed. So there is, and this is part of a systematic control, a campaign to control and censor the internet. So it is really vital that this be opposed. We are carrying out a international petition campaign. There is a link on the page. We urge everyone, if you haven't already, to click the button and sign our petition to stop Google censorship of the WSWS and other left-wing websites. Finally, we urge very strongly that everyone who is listening make as big a sacrifice as possible financially to support the WSWS, to enable us to continue to hold events such as this. And there is a button again on the page that you can click to make a donation. With that, I would like to begin the question and answer period. Okay, we've gotten a whole number of questions. The first one I will give to Comrade Tom is the following. Why did Kerensky support the right-wing General Kornilov? Didn't he call himself a socialist and a revolutionary?
Kerensky did call himself a socialist and a revolutionary. Actually, in one of Trotsky's writings from before the revolution, he made the point, he actually quoted a phrase from the Bible, not everyone who says, Lord, Lord, is allowed into heaven, and likewise, not everyone who calls themselves a socialist is a socialist. The world is full today in 2017 of many people who call themselves socialists. Bernie Sanders, for example. But these figures, other than calling themselves a socialist, have little to do with the history and traditions of the socialist movement, or with anything that might be called socialism. Kerensky did call himself a socialist. Actually, as was said in the film Tsar to Lenin, Kerensky tried to combine the right and left wings of the Russian Revolution. He tried to have peace and war till final victory. He tried to have capitalism and socialism. He tried to combine it all together with, you know, prolix writings and speeches, but ultimately he was unable, obviously, to bring these two irreconcilable positions together. So when, as the narrator says in Tsar to Lenin, he couldn't have peace and war till final victory, so he chose war till final victory. And when he chose war till final victory, it was necessary for him then, as a consequence of that, to repress the Bolshevik Party. And in the aftermath of the July days, that's what he did. The Bolshevik leaders were imprisoned, thrown into jail. Lenin was forced into hiding, and the Bolshevik papers were seized and their presses were shut down. And so after Kerensky, having taken that turn to the right, was then compelled to, by the logic of his own position, to bring himself into closer and closer alliance with the cadets and with the right-wing forces of the old Tsarist administration, including Kornilov. Now, what was going on in Kerensky's mind, I can't speculate, but it's clear that he was happy with a situation where he was at the head of the government, he was the supreme head, the dictator, and Kornilov was the head of the army. Whereas Kornilov would have been happy if he was the head of the government and Kerensky was a minister in the government. That accounts for Kerensky's efforts to bring in Kornilov. Now, as I made the point that when the New York Times and these other historians are writing about what the alternative was to Bolshevism, they completely leave out the name of Kornilov. They also omit the right-wing turn that Kerensky made during the July days and afterwards.
There are several questions we've gotten relating to the question of the factory committees, their role in the Russian Revolution, and the role that such committees could play today. For example, one listener wrote, what is the relationship between the factory committees? What was particular to the structure of the factory committees which allowed them to stand so far to the left even the Soviets, and what was their relationship to the Soviets? There was another question, said, in the previous lecture I came across the words shop committees and factory committees. Do these two represent different organs or are they the same? What is the relationship of these committees with the trade unions? And then finally, there's a question, what is the relationship between the factory committees established during the Russian Revolution and the rank and file committees which the Socialist Equality Party and the International Committee advocate workers to build today? So there's a whole series of questions relating to this.
Let me begin by saying this. The International Committee of the Fourth International supports the formation of factory and workplace committees. If you want to form a committee at your workplace, contact the ICFI in your area through the World Socialist website. We are ready to advise and assist in these efforts. On the question of labor unions, factory committees, and Soviets in 1917, these were specific organizational forms. The distinction, as I said, between the labor unions and the factory committees was that the factory committees exercised some form of control, or workplace control. I want to also make the point, though, about form and content. I think it's important not to place too much emphasis on the forms, the specific organizational forms and structure that were used in 1917, Soviets and factory committees. Actually, Trotsky in 1931 was critical of efforts to raise these historical forms into abstract and permanent categories that would remain absolutely true for all time. As I said, these were specific organizational forms. In 1931, Trotsky was very critical of the Stalinists' policy in Germany, which involved suddenly proclaiming that communist workers in Germany should form Soviets. Trotsky wrote, and this is from his writings on Germany, quote, "According to the official view prevailing at the present time," in other words, the Comintern in 1931, "the proletarian revolution can only be accomplished by means of the Soviets, where the Soviets have to arise directly for the purpose of the armed uprising. This stereotype is absolutely worthless. The Soviets are only an organizational form. The question is decided by the class content of the policy and in no case by its form. In Russia, the conciliationist Soviets turned against the workers and soldiers in July 1917. That is why Lenin, for a long time, took into account that we would have to carry out the armed uprising not with the aid of the Soviets, but of the factory committees. This calculation was refuted by the course of events, for we succeeded, in the month and a half to 2 months before the uprising, in winning over the most important Soviets. Yet this example alone shows how little we are inclined to consider Soviets as the all-saving means. In the fall of 1923, defending against Stalin and the others, the necessity of passing over to the revolutionary offensive, I fought," this is Trotsky, "I fought at the same time against the creation of Soviets in Germany on command, side by side with the factory councils, which were already beginning to fulfill the role of Soviets," unquote. Now Trotsky, of course, is approaching these questions as a Marxist. The critical feature of the factory council or committee or whatever organizational form is used or whatever name it's given is its class content. I would actually encourage listeners to read or reread, as the case may be, Marxism and the Trade Unions, which is a chapter in the book The Russian Revolution and the Unfinished 20th Century. And the title of that chapter is Why Are the Trade Unions Hostile to Socialism? In that chapter, David North describes the trade unions as, quote, "a definite social form." Our job is always to ask, what is the relation of these organizations to the class struggle in general and to the liberation of the workers from capitalist exploitation in particular? Also, does it further socialist consciousness and the fight for its development in the working class? These are the principal considerations for a Marxist and for a Marxist party. Now, when it comes to the trade unions, the trade unions today have undergone a colossal degeneration. They responded to globalization by integrating themselves into management. Workers need their own organizations. Our demand for the formation of, or our call for workers to form rank and file committees is a recognition that they cannot fight for, secure, or advance their interests through the existing trade unions. And those listeners who are interested in reading more about those questions should, of course, read that chapter of the Russian Revolution and the Unfinished 20th Century. Let me pause there and see if we can take another question.
I'd like to just add, in relationship to this question of the factory committees and the relationship between the effort today on the part of our movement to encourage workers to form such committees. There is and was a sort of objective content to the emergence of the Soviets in Russia. That is to say, the working class does instinctively gravitate, as Lenin explains in What Is to Be Done, first of all, in the direction of socialism, and also in the struggle to fight, and it seeks those forms through which it can independently organize itself to conduct such a struggle. And Lenin in State and Revolution recognized the emergence of Soviets as a form in which the future worker state was emerging, although, as Comrade Tom said quite correctly, he was by no means idealized the Soviets or sort of made a fetish out of them. So there is a very, and we are, yeah, and there, so there is a real connection, very powerful connection between the role that these organizations of the working class played in 1917 and the fight to establish such organizations or similar organizations, essentially revolutionary organizations, today. At the same time, without the intervention and leadership of the Bolshevik Party, the Soviets in Russia would not have been able to carry out the revolution, because insofar as they were politically dominated by the Mensheviks and the socialist revolutionaries, who subordinated the working class to the bourgeois provisional government, they would certainly have been smashed. I mean, the Kornilov coup would have succeeded, and everything that Tom outlined, you know, the horrific results would have taken place. So that there is a very, you know, complex and dialectical connection between the self-action of the working class and the political leadership of a revolutionary Marxist party, which becomes absolutely decisive. And what was true then is certainly true today. There is a question, let's see. Here's a question from a listener. I am kind of new to the historical study of the Russian Revolution. I am curious if there is a correlation between popular American disdain for communism and socialism and the negativity expressed toward the Jewish people in this country.
Well, I would say that the quotation I provided with respect to Denikin establishes the connection. I mean, they used the phrase Jew communists with a hyphen. That they consciously sought to whip that up to, you know, encourage the most backward layers and to mobilize them against the Bolsheviks. And that that connection, Jewish communism, Jewish Bolshevism, made its way to Berlin and all around the world. And it's interesting that, or not interesting, but one remarks when looking at the way that the right wing writes about the Russian Revolution, that this connection is always maintained. Now, is McMeekin, for example, an anti-Semite? I don't know. I can't see into his mind. But when he includes in his book long passages where he meditates on the supposed Jewishness of Trotsky and the Bolshevik leadership, it definitely leaves a sinister impression. These people are warming up the old prejudices that were whipped up in Europe against the Bolsheviks. So that's what I would say in response to that question.
There's a question, well, here's one question. What were the main differences between the Russian Revolution, Russian October Revolution of 1917, and the Ukrainian Maidan Square insurrection of February 24, 2014?
Well, the Maidan coup was a movement of far-right forces encouraged by the United States and Germany. The United States spent something like $5 billion building up far-right forces in the Ukraine, including the Svoboda Party of figures such as Oleg Tanibok. These figures really stand in the tradition of the white forces, not the reds. The hero of, or the heroes of the far right in the Ukraine are those forces which collaborated with the Nazis during the Second World War, including Stepan Bandera and others. The movement in, or the coup in Ukraine in 2014, I would say, had more in common with Kornilov and the Whites than with the Bolsheviks.
We have a question. Could you elaborate a bit more on how the Kornilov military brass went on to support the Nazis?
Well, many did. Many of the Whites who supported Kornilov and later supported the White Army, as a factual matter in terms of their biographies, went on to be either supporters or collaborators of the Nazis. I don't have in front of me a specific example to cite, but when we publish the lecture, I promise to include some footnotes where we name some names.
Okay. Here's a question. One can't help but sense the electricity, the critical energetic mass pulsating through the Russian working class. How much did geography and the concentration of the masses help create this as a variable in itself? What was the response in more isolated regions, and how does this translate for today?
Well, I mean, a Marxist, of course, approaches the development of the class struggle internationally from a scientific standpoint. As Trotsky says, not the imperialist war map, but the war map of the international class struggle. The Bolsheviks did look at the sort of concentration of the working class, the numbers of the working class throughout Russia as part of the development of their strategy and as their continual assessment and reassessment of the situation throughout the year. Lenin, of course, paid careful attention to the results of elections, the numbers of the working class, the numbers of the growth in the working class, the different strata of the peasantry and the increases and decreases in their numbers in the period leading up to the Russian Revolution. In Petrograd, there was a very large concentration of the working class and of course the factories in Petrograd, as Trotsky would remark, tended to be large, which was something that the Bolsheviks, that sort of accrued to the advantage of the Bolsheviks. So these are things that of course need to be taken into consideration. The Russian working class, let me say this. In July, when sections of the Petrograd working class wanted to seize power, Lenin opposed the seizure of power at that time because he felt that while the workers might carry Petrograd, they would not have the support of the masses throughout Russia. And he was fearful that if the working class in Petrograd took power, then at that time, the masses in the countryside would support the provisional government and the working class in Petrograd could be isolated and defeated, and a result could be it could result in 1871 and a repeat of what occurred in Paris. However, Lenin was obviously very sensitive to what was going on around the country. Once the Kornilov coup was defeated, there was a massive swing throughout the country in favor of the Bolsheviks. And actually at that time, there was also a surge in peasant unrest in the countryside that the provisional government moved to suppress. And Lenin's position was that at that time the masses were with the Bolsheviks, and if the Bolsheviks took power, they would have support around the country, which was true. It proved to be true that when the Bolsheviks took power, they found they had mass support around the country. There's accounts of Bolsheviks going into new areas, going to factories where they'd never gone before, and encountering Bolshevik support. And this changed very rapidly in the period of the revolution. So that's, of course, something that that Lenin and the Bolsheviks followed very carefully in 1917, and that a Marxist is obliged to follow today. And if you actually look at the World Socialist website, every day we're covering news and developments around the world. We are covering the struggles of the working class around the world and trying to develop a strategy and perspective based on the continuing dynamic development of the objective situation around the world.
Okay, there are two related questions I'd like to present. First of all, the first one is on the question of censorship, which is being intensified today. Can you explain in more detail how the Bolshevik Party in 1917 had to deal with being made illegal after July? And then there's another question. What did the factory committees do during July? Did the Red Guards defend the Bolsheviks or help them hide during the reaction? Were the committees also targeted by the Provisional Government in July?
Let me begin with the second question. In July, the reaction was very intense. The Bolshevik Party, for a period of time, had its internal organization completely disrupted. Their papers were shut down, their leaders were in jail. In many cases, the workers turned against them. Remember, the slander was, and this was published in all the newspapers and repeated by all of the other parties, the Bolshevik Party had accepted German money and was using German money to support the German war effort by undermining sort of the Russian society. And Lenin specifically had accepted the German gold. And this slander was widely circulated and repeated by the Mensheviks and the SRs. And this did have an incredibly devastating effect on the Bolsheviks for a short period of time. They had to get their papers out in a different form. They issued new papers, and it's actually a remarkable organizational feat that they were able to resume publication so quickly under conditions of censorship. So that's certainly true. There's an account of a worker who was trying to distribute Bolshevik newspapers who was killed trying to distribute them. And so the factory committees themselves were nominally non-party or formally non-party. The Bolsheviks played a leading role in encouraging the working class to set them up, and Bolsheviks played a leading role in the factory committees. In the factory committees, there was a core of Bolshevik workers in most committees, but there were other workers in the committees, non-party workers, workers from other political tendencies, and in the period after July, I would imagine that many of those, in many cases, workers turned against the Bolshevik Party, and it was necessary for the Bolshevik Party to patiently rebuild itself and reconstitute itself. And in 1917, things went very rapidly. With respect to the Red Guards, yes, the Red Guards were dramatically reduced in number after July. The Provisional Government made every effort to illegalize them, to shut them down, to sort of assimilate them into other organizations. They confiscated the weapons and disarmed them. But as I said, there remained a sort of core of Bolshevik workers in the Red Guards. They preserved their weapons wherever possible, and of course they continued to work underground at that point to expand and develop the Red Guards, and that's what enabled the Petrograd to defend itself from Kornilov. If the Bolsheviks had not been there, if the Bolsheviks had not developed and preserved the Red Guards, if the Bolsheviks had not warned the working class repeatedly against the danger of Kornilov, then there would have been nothing to stop him. Certainly the Mensheviks and the SRs would not have been able to stop Kornilov. And as we said, the result would have been a very different 20th century and a very different world today.
Just to add to that, I mean, the Bolshevik Party actually and the leadership made a very conscious decision during the July days to maintain as much as possible a legal as well as an underground existence. And in fact, the Bolsheviks continued to participate in the Soviets. And while their top leaders were indicted and many of them were jailed, they were not sort of formally, legally, you know, prescribed by the Provisional Government, which was, and I think there was also, by the way, this was quite important, that there was a discussion within the leadership over what Lenin should do, because, of course, in the midst of this incredible hysterical libel against the Bolshevik Party and Lenin as being, you know, in the pay of the German general staff, which did have a certain impact, even in the working class. The fact that Lenin did not, appear, did not remain to go on trial and sort of legally, you know, defend himself, did have certain negative consequences initially. But it was decided, and Lenin came to this position, that, if he did not go underground, that they would simply assassinate him, which was undoubtedly a correct assessment of the situation. They made a certain assessment of the political situation and the relationship of class forces. And while the July days was a very serious setback, nevertheless, the fact remained that the Provisional Government was massively discredited, and that the fundamental trajectory of the revolution had not been altered, and they were quite confident that the situation would shift, and in fact, Trotsky in the history of the Russian Revolution makes the point that as the situation changed, for example, you had the collapse of the Kerensky military offensive, and despite that, you had the Mensheviks, the SRs, the Provisional Government insisting on continuing the war, continuing to send the Russian soldiers into the meat grinder of the war. Conditions in the city and in the whole country continue to deteriorate, a food crisis, inflation, and so forth. Under those conditions, the fact that it was the Bolsheviks who had been targeted particularly for repression, whose warnings were being completely vindicated, ended up strengthening the Bolshevik Party and reinforcing the authority of the Bolsheviks in the working class and also among the soldiers and growing sections of the peasantry. So they made a certain assessment of the actual class relations. And I think there is a parallel to our response to the censorship of Google in relationship to the World Socialist website. We make a certain political assessment, and we conclude that this is extremely dangerous and has to be opposed and has to be beaten back, but it takes place under conditions where it's really the bourgeoisie who is in tremendous and deepening crisis. And this is, in a certain sense, an act of desperation. They are playing out all of their cards. They have nothing to offer to address the immense social crisis and the concerns facing broad masses of people. They're increasingly discredited, despised, in the end, so what is their answer? They claim that the growth of social opposition, political opposition in the United States is the result of a, sort of demonic Russian president, Putin, and that's what's causing all the trouble, and that the answer is to basically censor the internet and clamp down on socialist and left-wing views, which is really, it is a certain measure of their desperation. And we are therefore quite confident that as a result of the campaign that we're conducting, that the World Socialist website will, the readership will grow. And in fact, our readership has grown, despite, at least, in recent period, despite the censorship being carried out. So there is definitely a certain parallel there. There's a very basic question that was asked, which certainly, deserves a response. You explain that socialist consciousness has to be brought into the working class through the Revolutionary Party. Why is it that spontaneous struggles do not lead workers to draw this conclusion on their own?
Well, this is the subject of Lenin's What is to be Done? And this is something that is just a historical law and historical experience, which has been confirmed many times in the negative and, of course, in the Russian Revolution in the affirmative. It does not suffice for workers to become aware that the conditions that they live in or work in have become intolerable. That much happens, in a sense, automatically or spontaneously. Instead, it's necessary for workers to understand why the conditions had become intolerable, to understand the intolerable conditions as part of, or as a product of, the whole reactionary social order, and to understand that the intolerable conditions can only be addressed by the reorganization of world society on a more advanced democratic and rational level. And the latter form of consciousness requires the intervention of a revolutionary Marxist party, because it requires a scientific appreciation for, again, why the society is going into crisis, over and understanding it on the long curve of its whole historical development. I'd also like to, with respect to the question about far-right forces in Russia who went on to support the Nazis, I admit that I probably should have anticipated that question, but here's an example. Nikolai Markov was a far-right Russian political figure and supporter of the Black Hundreds. He was close to General Yudenich. He went on in 1928, after fleeing the Bolsheviks, to become a follower of the Nazi Party. He also undertook lecture tours and conducted propaganda for the Nazis in the 1930s. So there is actually a physical connection between the White Army and the white pro-white forces, the Russian far right, and the far right in Germany.
We have a question. Can Comrade Tom expand on the counter-revolution in Finland, as well as areas of Russia the White Armies controlled for a time during the Russian Civil War?
Well, during the Russian Civil War, the White Armies conducted what was known as the White Terror in the areas that they controlled, and sort of massacred workers, communists, socialists, left-wing individuals, wherever they could find them. Kornilov's motto was, the greater the terror, the greater the victory. That was the, once the Bolsheviks had established Soviet power, they were required to defend it from the whites. With respect to Finland, I would encourage the listeners to read the biographical sketch of Ivar Smilga, prepared by and published on the World Socialist website by Clara Weiss, which contains a more detailed exposition of that experience. But once the once counter-revolutionaries came to power in Finland, they carried out a horrible massacre of socialist workers and of the working class in general. And as I said, the estimate is that approximately 100,000 workers were killed in the counter-revolutionary bloodbath. And certainly the Bolsheviks drew and learned from that experience. in terms of how they were to deal with the white forces and what and the consequences, what the consequences would be if they were defeated.
We have a question. The last lecture by Barry Gray addressed the quotation by Marx that, quote, the class struggle necessarily leads to the dictatorship of the proletariat, end quote. Can you elaborate a bit about how this statement was expressed concretely through the committees in 1917?
Well, that pertains to your lecture. Would you like to address it?
I think that as actually Comrade Tom has explained in great detail, the actual course of the revolution itself demonstrated that there was really no possibility for the working class to survive, for the revolution to survive and avoid a counter-revolutionary bloodbath on the basis of the sort of state structures of the capitalist state. There was no, you know, bourgeois democratic or gradual reformist way from, or path from capitalism and imperialist war to socialism, or at least the beginning of the construction of socialism, and an ending of the war. The actual revolution demonstrated that the whole, in that sense, program of the Mensheviks, which insisted that in the Russian Revolution, because Russia was a relatively backward country as opposed to the advanced capitalist countries of Europe, that the working class would could not take power into its own hands. That, in other words, it had to overthrow the Tsar and then set up a bourgeois democratic parliamentary government. And then, you know, from some indefinite period, it would be a sort of opposition within the framework of bourgeois democracy. And only when industry and so forth had developed in Russia to the level it existed in the more advanced countries, could you even talk about socialism? Well, the complete bankruptcy of that perspective and falseness of it was demonstrated in the actual events of the revolution itself. What was in fact demonstrated was that the proletariat, the working class, faced the necessity not simply to take over the existing state machinery, not as, for example, I pointed out in the last lecture, Karl Kautsky said, you know, our program is for the working class through it, the Social Democratic Party, to win a majority in parliament and make parliament the master of the country. That is our program. Well, I mean, you know, this was a completely utopian and false perspective, that what was necessary was for the working class, through its own organs of struggle and of rule, to take power and smash the capitalist state. And that's what happened in the form of the revolution through the Soviets under the leadership of the Bolshevik Party. In fact, because, you know, revolutions in a certain sense are gigantic historical experiments. You know, various theories are tested out. And this revolution proved the absolute correctness of the political line, first of all, of Trotsky's theory of permanent revolution, which insisted that in the epoch of imperialism, the task of the democratic revolution, land reform, democratic reform, so forth, could only actually be carried out under the worker state, which would immediately begin the process of constructing a socialist society, and very critically, could only be done as part of an international world revolution. So this was verified very powerfully in a positive way in the Russian Revolution. So I think that with that, we will,
If it's all right with you, I'll say a few concluding,
go ahead.
Concluding remarks.
Please.
A lot of the questions have addressed the contemporary relevance of this material. And indeed, obviously, one of the purposes of this lecture is not to discuss a bunch of interesting historical facts, but to talk about events and experiences which are critical to understand today as we address the problems that we confront in the 21st century. There's a reason why these efforts are being made in the New York Times and the new slew of slanders against the Bolsheviks and, of course, against Trotsky in particular. To take the mass movement out of the working class, out of the October Revolution, is the historian's equivalent of writing that Mozart had nothing to do with music or that Darwin had nothing to do with biology. This claim takes the biggest working class event in history and removes the working class from it. And there are, again, reasons for that. The fate of the Russian Revolution was ultimately tragic. The leaders of the movement we've been describing were exterminated in a political genocide in the USSR in the course of the Stalinist counter-revolution. Its best representatives, including Leon Trotsky and his supporters in the left opposition, were hunted down, and efforts were made to silence them around the world. And where are these political traditions alive today? Outside of the International Committee of the Fourth International, one searches for them in vain. And thanks to the heroic efforts of generations of Trotskyists who served in this movement, who kept the torch burning under very difficult conditions, the heritage and traditions of this cause are preserved for a new generation of workers and youth to take up around the world. And this is what we're attempting to impart in this series of lectures. A certain qualified optimism is warranted. The world capitalist system in 2017, with Donald Trump at the helm, does not exactly inspire confidence. Governments and ruling establishments are turning to the right and sliding backwards. They do not have a progressive solution to any of the problems we face. Meanwhile, social opposition is mounting around the world and looking for ways to express itself. In the masses, there's a sentiment that the old system must go, and there's a growing interest in socialism. The Bolsheviks had to make do in 1917 with typesetters and telegraphs and printing presses, but today we have computers and the internet. Through the World Socialist website, the perspective of socialist internationalism is accessible in seconds all around the world. This accounts, by the way, for the determined efforts of Facebook and Google to censor and remove WSWS material from search results. The powers that be are afraid that one day the WSWS and its perspective could, as we say nowadays, go viral. And that's why this history has such powerful contemporary relevance. The workers of Petrograd were not struggling as workers of Petrograd or as workers of Russia, but as members of the international working class under the slogan, "Proletarians of all countries unite." And their histories, their victories, their sacrifices belong to all the workers of the whole world.
Before we conclude, I want to remind all of our listeners that next Saturday at the same time, we will have the next lecture in this series. The title is Lessons of October, the Political Crisis Within the Bolshevik Party on the Eve of the Seizure of Power. The lecturer will be Chris Marsden, who is the National Secretary of the Socialist Equality Party in Britain. And with that, I think we should all give Comrade Tom a warm thanks and applause for this excellent and very inspiring lecture.